And so as our kids head off to children's worship or parents take kiddos to nursery, boy, isn't that great? That's a sign of a healthy church when a quarter of your church gets up and heads out. I love that. Usually preachers would not like that, but I love the fact that there are so many little ones around here as they make their way out. For the past several years, it has been this church's great blessing to have our brother, Fate Haygood, come in from Los Angeles and the Metropolitan Church of Christ to be away from them today. We appreciate the sacrifice that they are making because their loss is our gain. We bring Fate in. He graciously comes in to lead and speak at our men's retreat, and he once again, I can't even say once again, because that would imply that he did this past weekend what he has always done, which is a home run. Well, if the past have been home runs, this past weekend was a grand slam after grand slam after grand slam. Amen to that. Amen to that. I did not know anything new could come out of the David and Goliath story. Everything was new. And when Jesus said, I'm making all things new, he wasn't lying through Fate's heart and through his mind and God's scripture through him. We're blessed today to have Fate's wife also with him, Myra, if you would raise your hand. Let's give Myra, we're glad to have you here with us today. And I don't want to take any more of Fate's time. Fate, if you would come up, I'm going to pray over you. Brothers and sisters, if you don't mind, let's grab a hand of the person next to you. We're family here. Dear Lord, we love Fate and how you have allowed our paths to cross with this leader in your church here in this world, Father. And Father, how we have been blessed to just once a year catch the flavor of your Son that comes through knowing him, Father. We love Father Christ, and we love the way that our brother Fate presents through heart and soul our precious Lord Jesus to us. Be with his church back home, your church, Father, that he ministers to. May today be a great Sunday for them, and we're thankful he is here today. May your word be preached. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Good morning. Amen. Good morning. Really? Good morning. Thank you. It is my honor to be here with you today. I'm just thankful to be called and to be able to minister in whatever way I can. I'm hoping that on this morning we can venture into God's faithfulness. I want to say that I am super impressed with the elders, the leadership, the ministers here at Park Plaza. They have been overly gracious to me, better than I even kind of deserve. So I am just thankful. I'm just trying to figure out why y'all keep bringing me back. I mean, thank you, but amen. I told the ministers and some of the members there at Brookside that I was going to give them a shout out. Because they were mad that I couldn't come over there and be with them today. So I said, okay, I'll give you a shout out this morning. Ain't God good? Yes, he is. And all the time. Yes, indeed. We are going to be in 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And we're going to read verses 1 through 13. 1 Corinthians, 10th chapter, commencing with verse 1, concluding with verse 13. When you get there, say amen. Oh, amen. Most of us are already there. That's awesome. Now we're waiting for the five people who aren't there yet. The Bible says in verse number 1, Moreover, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware that all our fathers were under the cloud, all passed through the sea, all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea, all ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. But with most of them, God was not well pleased, for their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now these things became our examples to the intent that we should not lust after things as they also lusted. And do not become idolaters as were some of them. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Nor let us commit sexual immorality as some of them did. And in one day, 23,000 fell. Nor let us tempt Christ as some of them also tempted and were destroyed by serpents. Nor complain as some of them also complained and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now, all these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the ages have come. Therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. No temptation has taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Amen? Amen. Before I begin, I want you to just help me preach just a little bit. If you're sitting close to anybody, I want you to look them right in the eye right now. Just look at them right in the eye and tell them, don't be like one of them. Did they believe you? Well, if they didn't believe you, look at someone else and tell them, don't be like one of them. Oh, there's people in the balcony. Shout out to the balcony. Have you ever had a really good friend? I mean, a really good friend. Someone who gifted you with friendship and relationship. Someone that said, no matter what, I'm down. I'll be with you forever, no matter what. Have you ever had someone commit to you on the deepest level? Say, you know what? No matter if everybody else forsakes you, I'm with you. You ever had what they call a BFF? Someone that says, you know, we're besties. You know, that is one of the greatest gifts a person can give. Commitment to you. I've had people say, I'm with you. No matter what happens, I'll be there. And that is the greatest feeling in the world. For me, it was even more amazing because I've never really had people who did that for me. I've always been that guy that was the one who everybody said, okay, go do it. And then they said, yeah, we'll be with you. And it's like the old Gomer Pyle skit, where Gomer is standing in line with all the rest of the recruits. And they say, if you want to volunteer, step forward. And everybody else steps back. And he's standing there by himself. The most hurtful time in my life, though, was when those whom I loved, whom I believed in, had finally given me that. I was fine when they didn't give it to me. But when they gave it to me, it was euphoric. And then they reached out and snatched it back. The most hurtful time in my life was when someone who said they were going to be faithful took that gift from me. I'm here to tell you today, God will never do that. I'm here to tell you, God is faithful. God, by definition, is faithful. And before I deal with this text, and I really won't be long this morning, before I deal with this text just a little bit, I do want to talk to you a little bit. And here's what I want to say. I know there's been times you have felt God was not there. I know there have been times you felt all alone and by yourself. Let me give you a theological tidbit. That is an existential impossibility. God is omnipresent. It is literally impossible for God not to be somewhere. It never happened. Well, you say, well, God left me. Didn't happen. God forsook me. Never happened. Oh, yes, it did. No, did not. But I felt, well, that's what you felt. That was your emotional reality, and it was real. But the real of the real was God has never left you. Let me tell you one more thing before we look here. I know someone probably told you because of what you have done or who you are or what you have attained that because of that, God's love was less with you. It is impossible for you as a human being to increase or decrease the love of God. The love of God is not rooted in what you do, say, think, or feel. The love of God is rooted in who God is. God is love, and he just can't help himself. God is faithful. He literally cannot not be faithful. It's who he is. Oh, that's good to me, though. Amen. Yeah. Because I don't know about you, but sometimes I don't feel all that great about me, and I don't feel all that great about my relationship with God. And I don't feel all that great about how I'm treating God or how I perceive God to be treating me. And we get in this place, this headspace, where we start to feel all by ourselves and all alone. And then the enemy starts to lie and whisper in our ears and tell us, you know, you're low down, dirty, good for nothing, you know. And we start to believe that is what is real. I'm here to tell you, brothers and sisters, it is not real. God is faithful. All right. Verse number 11 first. He says here, the apostle says, now all these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the ages have come. All these things, and that's the reason I read verses 1 through 10. All those things where he talked about them committing sexual immorality and in one day 23,000 falling and them tempting Christ. And they were being destroyed by serpents and all of the horrible things they did in the wilderness and all these bad things happened. And you can start to say, well, see, ha ha, I got you. There's your cause and effect. effect. Because they did this, God did that. Because they did this, God didn't love them. No, no, no. What the apostle is saying is all these things were happening purposefully for us. God allowed things to happen as examples for us, so they might be warnings or admonitions to us. It's very interesting, this word examples. Now all these things happen as an example to us. This word example means to make an impression. No, no, not like make an impression like you see a cute girl coming like, ooh, I'm impressed. No, have you ever, when you were in school, how many of you had a bully? Was there ever a bully at the school? How many of you ever thought you were gonna test the bully to see if he was really who he said he was? And you came home and you either had this big knot on your head or a nice shiner under here. That is this word here, example, tupikos. It means to make a physical manifestation of an outward cause. It means that something real happened to indicate that something else has happened. And he said these examples were supposed to affect us in such a way that they made a physical manifestation. In other words, when people were to see them, they should have known that they had been in fight with the bully. They should look at them and say, oh, he got a black eye. He ran up against Ted today. He got a big knot on his head. Yep, that was Ted. What the apostle is trying to get us to see is that the people of God should look at those stories and be so affected by them that it manifests physically, that it becomes the witness of their lives. That these stories aren't just stories, but these stories are God's way of socking us in the, of God putting a physical marker on us so that people can see who we are. Isn't it incredible how we have to give a witness? We have to tell our testimony. And what God is saying here, or at least the apostle is saying, is those things which were happening to them should have, it so affected us that when people look at us, they automatically see, yep, that person has been with God. These things happened as an example to us. So they might be warnings. This word, nousesia, warnings. Back in the day, there was this guy named Jay Adams, I believe it was his name. He wrote a lot of stuff about counseling. And he championed this idea of nouthetic counseling. That's his word, nousesia. And it was the idea of confrontational counseling. So it's like you go to a counselor and you say, well, you know, I really got a problem today. He says, well, what's the problem? Well, my problem is I drink too much. And the counselor says, well, stop doing that. That's kind of nouthetic counseling, where you come and you just, you know, somebody says, well, you know, I'm really having a problem with stealing. Well, stop stealing. That's nouthetic counseling, this idea of a warning, a strong warning. And what he's saying is what should have happened is, as we interact with these stories should make such an impact on us that they have an impression and they serve as a warning. Now all these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the ages have come. Because of this, therefore, he says, let him who thinks he stands take heed, lest he fall. Because of this, he says, be careful. Let him who thinks he stands, because of these stories, be careful. God's faithfulness also tells us that God is utterly consistent. Be careful, he says. Take heed, lest you fall. Be careful when you think you stand. Take heed, lest you fall. This idea of thinking you stand, it's a thing called dokeo. Don't worry, you're not gonna remember that. But back in the day when they were trying to figure out the Christian faith, they had a council at a place called Nicaea. And there at Nicaea, they had a group of heretics called the Docetics. And what the Docetics said, the Docetic Gnostics, is they said that Jesus didn't really come. That Jesus just appeared to come. He was a phantom. He kind of looked like he came. He was here, but he wasn't really here. He seemed to come. People thought he'd come. He came. Well, that's this word dokeo. He says, let him who thinks he stands, who has fooled himself into believing he's appearing to stand. He's saying there's something going on in our minds that makes us think that we are somehow better than other folks who have who've experienced the same thing. You know, it's so funny. We say, why is it funny? Here's why it's funny. I counsel a lot of folk, and I talk to lots of people, and invariably, I will talk to a young lady, and I will tell her, you know what? This dude you got is a bum. Let him go. No, no, no. But I love him. I'm like, wait a minute. He cheated on Sally. He cheated on Betty. Cheated on Mary. Cheated on Joanne. He's going to cheat on you. No, no, no. Not me. My love will overcome. Yo. You think you're standing. You think you're standing. You need to pay attention. He says, lest you fall. Pride, the wise man said, goes before a fall. This idea of thinking before you fall. It's like those stories are shouting at you pneuthetically. Stop it. Leave this dude. Stop it. You're going, no, no, no. I got this. And all these stories say, no, no, no. No, no, no. I got this. And they're saying, hey, you're really, really close to the edge. And you say, no, no, I can stand here. He says, no, 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 you don't understand, you're gonna fall. That's what pride does for us. It puts us in a position where we fall. And so he says, take heed, lest you fall. My worst times and my worst mess ups because when I think, I got this. I got this. I got this. Knowing that it has me. I don't have it. It has me. But I have fooled myself into believing that I can handle it. He says, so no, no, no. Take heed lest you fall. There's no temptation taking you, but such as is common to man. He says, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted above what you are able, but will with the temptation make a way of escape. No temptation has overtaken you, but such as is common to man. No temptation, no parasmos. This idea of being squeezed to prove what's inside. That's what temptation is. Temptation is when you're going through something that squeezes you to prove how genuine whatever is inside you is. Parasmos. It shows the genuineness of our faith. It shows through trials or through tribulations what is going on. You say, well, nothing's gonna prove me because I am a strong Christian. I'm like Peter. Yeah, I probably are. Jesus told Peter, you know what? Before the cock crows, you'll deny me three times. And Peter said, oh no, not me. Lord, I'll be with you forever, though all others forsake you. And of course we know the story. Before the cock crowed, three times, he denied him. Matter of fact, it got so bad, he started cussing about it. Do you know him? No, I don't know him.
Second time. Do you know him? No, you know, I don't know him. Third time. I told you I don't know the man. Because all of a sudden, it got to the point where Peter was realizing that he was close to the edge and he was falling off. And did Peter fall? Yes, he did, with a resounding crash. But God is faithful. If you remember the story of Peter, even though Peter fell and even though Peter denied Christ three times, the Lord still accepted him back. Oh, don't worry. If you're going to be a young church, you got to have babies, though. Amen. Amen. I love babies. Amen. He says, therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. No temptation has taken you except such as is common to man, but God is faithful. No temptation has overtaken you. The thing about temptation is this, is that temptation sets traps for us. And the funny thing about temptation is temptation never sets a trap for you that you don't want. Let me say that again. Temptation never sets a trap for you that you don't want. You're never going to be tempted with something you can't stand. You'll notice broccoli is never a temptation. If you're on a diet, you're not going to suddenly see a whole lot of broccoli commercials. If you're on a diet, it's going to be like chocolate and cake. Because temptation is a technique of a tempter or temptress. And what the tempter does is he sets the bait so that it immediately connects with a legitimate need within the target. So if you're a good, strong, straight guy, he's gonna send you some woman. Or if you're this really, really, are you coming for me? Amen. If you're this really, really lonely,
test. If you're this really, really lonely woman, he's going to send you a guy that looks like the man of your dreams. Or if you are a person who loves to speed, he will suddenly give you an opportunity to drive the new Porsche. It's never something you don't want. That's the reason temptation is so hard to deal with. Because as James says, it hooks in with a legitimate need within you. Every man is tempted, James says, when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then lust, when it has conceived, bring forth sin. Sin, when it is finished, bring forth death. There's something in us that needs something, and the devil wants us to, in the wrong way, illegitimately fulfill that need, and that's why he tempts us with the things that are bad for us. No temptation has taken you, he says, except such as is common to man. What does that mean, common to man? What he's telling you is that you aren't going through anything. You aren't going through anything that is not about humans. You're not being tempted like spiritual beings are tempted. And that's, you know, sometimes I say, you know what, we need to be careful judging the devil so harshly. Yeah, he's a bad dude. Don't get me wrong. What I'm saying is we don't know the level of temptation that exalted spiritual beings had. We only know human stuff. And human stuff, he says, humans can deal with. No temptation has taken you, but such as is common to man. He says, but God is faithful. And I love that. The faithfulness of God lets me know that no matter what, God is a covenant-keeping God. that God never looks and says, you know what? No, I'm going to let you go. I'm going to just leave you to your... No. He says, God is faithful, and he will, with the temptation, make a way of escape. God is faithful. Woo! You can never not depend on God, because God is faithful. God is covenantally faithful, meaning no matter what, he's a covenant-keeping God. He says in Deuteronomy, I will never break my covenant. I will never break my covenant. Can someone say never? Can someone just shout never? Can you just say never? Never is a long time, man. And never is longer than you will be a human. And he says, as a human being, you have a time limit, but the faithfulness of God does not. God is faithful. I don't know how to tell you how much that encourages me and gives me hope. Because I'm not faithful. I try to be, but I'm not. I try to be right, but every now and then, I'm undependable. And I put myself in situations that I shouldn't have put myself in. But even when I put myself in a situation I should not have been in, the Bible tells me that God is faithful, that he will never leave me. He will never forsake me. He's always by my side. He always is on my side. He always does what is best for me. God is faithful. He's caringly faithful. He will not allow me to be tempted above which I am able. Somebody says, no, you don't understand my problems. I have a trial. I'm being squeezed in such a way that I just can't deal with this. Have you ever said that? I just can't deal with this. I just can't deal with this. You're having a God problem, not a you problem. For some reason, we believe that if we're in this situation that's really bad, that we just can't take it. Tell you right now, yes, you can. Because God literally will never get you in a situation that he will not make a way within it. He is faithful, and you can trust him. You won't look up one day and God is gone. And we have done that with people, haven't we? You looked up and you thought they were going to be there and they're gone. But God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. I want you to notice, though, it did not say he will not allow you to be tempted. He says he will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, inherently able to deal with. This word dunamis, you are inherently able to deal with. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able to deal with. Never. Say never again. Never. Say never. Never. If you had a problem today, and I don't care what the problem is, it could be a financial problem. You say, I just don't know what to do. I have to do something to make some money. If that something is something that is not of God, you never have to do it. Well, I'm having family problems right now, and I need to handle this situation. If that situation is asking you to do something that God would not want you to do, you never have to do that. Well, you don't know, I'm having a relational problem. If it's asking you to do something that God does not want you to do, don't do it. Always walk in the faithfulness of God. And say to yourself, you know what? I don't care. Just like Job, if he slays me, yet will I trust him. I will never forsake God because God has never forsaken me. He says it himself. He says, listen, within his character, I cannot deny myself. I remain faithful. He will never, ever leave you, no matter how bad your temptation or your trial is. Let me close by saying this. He says, now God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted above what you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Oh God, He will with the temptation. He will with the temptation, Jesus. He will with the temptation. Oh God, y'all ain't missing this. He will with the temptation. Oh, y'all are missing this. He will with the temptation. He won't take the temptation away. What he's saying is, while you are going through whatever you're going through, he will with the temptation. That no matter what's going on with the temptation, God will make a way of escape because God is a way maker. Oh, yes, he is. God is a way maker. That doesn't mean that when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were cast into the fiery furnace, it does not mean that God is going to turn out the fire. It just means that while they are in the fiery furnace, God will supply some faithful asbestos. And so that no matter what's going in the fire, he will, with the temptation, make a way of escape. Am I right about it? It's not saying he's going to remove the lions from the lion's den. Oh, no, 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 no. The lions are going to stay in the lion's den. But he's going to give the lions lockjaw because he deals with your stuff with. Oh, am I getting too loud? I'm sorry. I almost forgot where I was. Let me be nicer. But he will with the temptation. He will make a way of escape with the temptation. No, you don't have to leave your wife. If you trust God, he will give you strength to deal with your wonderful wife. Or your knuckleheaded husband. Amen, somebody. Because he deals with it with the temptation. But that's when it gets a kind of oxymoronish. Because it says he will, with the temptation, make a way of escape so that you may be able to bear it. You say, why is that so contradictory? Well, he says, first, I'm going to let you escape it. Then he says, I'm going to let you bear it. Which one is it? Am I going to bear it or am I going to escape it? Sometimes your escape is in your bearing it. Your escape is in him giving you the ability to deal with it. Let us close by saying, God is faithful. God is faithful. He will. Oh, y'all don't believe it yet. He will. Oh, y'all don't believe it yet. He will. Okay, now you kind of with the temptation. Make a way. Make a way. Make a way. Woo! Isn't that awesome? Isn't that awesome? You want to freak? You want to freak your friends out? The next time something's going crazy, you're at school like chilling out and something goes crazy. And you see like this really fine girl. And you're trying to be cool. And your friends say, did you see that girl? Tell them, God's making a way. God's making a way. I've prayed about it already. And he's going to give me the ability to bear it. It'll really freak him out. Say it with me. God will make a way of escape. God bless you. God is faithful.